Good evening. I would like to call the planning board meeting to order on June 12th, 2012, at the Newmarket Town Hall for a matter of recording the minutes. We have present with us this evening Jane Ford, our alternate, Ed Carmichael, a full member, town council representative, Elizabeth Dudley, Rick McMiniman, Justin Norman, and Adam Schroeder. I would just like to note Diane Hardy's excused absence. Her brother passed away and she had other personal issues. And Janice will be joining us shortly. The planning board practice is to conclude our business by 10 p.m. and the board may vote to extend that if we're required to or if we feel a need to. With that said, if everyone please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Can everyone hear us back there? Great, thank you. On to the first order of business, I would also regrettably announce the resignation of Vice Chair Peter Roy. He and his family are moving from the area, so unfortunately we're losing him as a valued member of our board. Peter has served 6 years with the planning board. He actively participated in our capital improvements program committee and put in a lot of time with the technical review committee. So, and there's Janice. So he will be surely missed. And again, I'd like to welcome our new alternate member, Jane Ford. So at this time, we still have an opening for an alternate. And the planning board will also be taking, we'll be filling Peter's position. The planning board will vote to do that. So we still are looking for additional planning board members if anyone in the public is interested. Okay. And we have a quorum of four. And if I will appoint an alternate. At this time, I would like to open up the podium to any public comments of items that are not on the agenda. So if you are here for any item that is posted on the agenda or received a notice, and that is why you're here, we'll be hearing those comments when we deliberate on that particular issue. Any comments from the public? Seeing none, I will close the public comment section. We would next like to take up the approval of the minutes. April 10th, I think everyone has a copy of those. Do I hear a motion to approve?
Motion to approve the planning board minutes of April 10th with adjustments, if any.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
And the modifications or amendments?
I just have one, page 2, very last word on line 45. It's a 2-2 problem.
Two. Should be T-O.
T-O instead of T-O-O.
So just an edit?
Just an edit.
Okay. I have a change on page 5, line, the paragraph 2, third line down. At the end, it should say we as opposed to they. I mean, we're talking about the planning board here. And that was my only comment. Seeing no other comments, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Abstain.
Okay, Adam has abstained.
I will too.
And Justin was, that was for the 10th.
Yeah.
And Justin was excused. Motion passes. The May 8th meeting minutes, those are posted, you know, as required by the RSA, but they have not been reviewed by the town planner, so I would like a motion to continue that approval of the May 8th, 2012 meeting minutes to our July meeting.
Make a motion to continue the approval of the May meeting, planning board meeting minutes to the July meeting.
Second.
Any comments, discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Let the minutes show the motion approved. Next, I would like to make an appointment of an alternate to fulfill Peter Roy's position for this meeting, and I would like to appoint Adam as our alternate member to serve on any voting tonight. Jane, you're included in all the deliberations, so you feel free to ask questions of the applicants or provide comments, ask questions of the board.
Thank you.
You just won't be able to vote on any motions. Okay. First order of regular business is the CRC Future Corporation. This is a continuation of a public hearing for an application for design review for a modification of a final subdivision and site plan approved on February 24th, 1987 at Durrell Woods, tax map R5, lot 132 in the R2 zone. The request is to allow the reconfiguration of lot 132, an 8.9-acre lot, from 13 four-unit buildings in one two-unit building, which is a total of 54 units, to 26 duplex units, a total of 52 units. Is the applicant here? Mr. Cheney?
Good evening.
My name's Walter Cheney. I'm the representative for CRC Future Corp. in this particular item. Per the request of our last meeting, the board had requested some information in regards to impervious changes in the site between the old and the new. With that, I added some other additional information. I provided that on Friday. I'm looking to see if the board received that and if they had time to review that.
Did everyone receive that?
No.
Okay.
I can share with her.
Okay.
And so with that, I guess I'm looking for direction from the board as to how to proceed.
Are any abutters here or any interested party that would like to make any comments? I think so that you're not recusing yourself.
No, I'm not.
And the board was fine with that.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Seeing that there are no public comments, I'll keep that open because this may take a different course. Any questions or comments from the board of the applicant? Did everyone have the ability to review Attorney Richardson's letter? Particularly his clarification letter.
The nature of substantial difference?
Exactly. And I'll read that so that we can kind of limit our discussion to this. In the letter dated May 7th, 2012, it's up to the town planning board and the code enforcement officer to examine whether any proposed use or improvements are substantially different, end quote, from those that are shown on the approved plan. To the extent buildings or uses are substantially different from those approved, they are subject to the town's current zoning ordinance and subdivision regulations. There's some indication that the approved plan was not intended to be conclusive of the final location of the units located on lot 68. This is a factual determination that needs to be made by the planning board or the code enforcement officer during our review of an application to develop the property. Even so, the approved plan shows that 3- and 4-unit structures were to be constructed and included designs for a typical driveway, parking and lighting for 4-unit structures. This change would appear to indicate that the proposed development is substantially different from that shown in the approved plan. However, that's a factual determination, and the attorney encourages the planning board to consider all the relevant information and make our appropriate determination with that regard. So that being said, if we can have some discussion and like to hear members' thoughts on whether the proposed plan, which is actually also left from the last meeting up here, relative to driveway locations, access, egress, we're talking about a change of the reduction in the building, in the units, increase in buildings, but going from the duplexes to quads. And I did get a call from Rick Malasky, so actually I should read this before we deliberate. Rick called me relative to his position as both the fire, relative to the fire department's position and the public works, as the public works director.
Excuse me?
Mm-hmm.
I believe did you intend to say, my understanding is that it's not going to be changed from duplex to quads the other way around?
Quads to duplexes.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
If I said that was incorrect. Thanks. So Mr. Malasky's position is that this is a better plan than what is shown on the approved site plan. The road and access is more user-friendly for the fire trucks and the emergency vehicles. The two-unit buildings are easier to manage and a lot less to protect during a fire. Evidently, in a conversation with the applicant, fire hydrants would be put in under this new plan. The water and the sewer hookups are all stumped in, but there would actually be a reduction, and some of those lines would be updated for the new construction if it was changed. There will be less pavement, impervious surface. He stated the applicant has always done what the public works or the fire department has requested on prior projects. And he brought up an issue of Hillside, which is that part of Durrell? It's another phase, or?
Yes.
That was redesigned in, he had mentioned 2005. I think your information said 2000.
It came before the board in 2000.
Okay.
And was built through 2005.
So in that instance, the roads and the buildings were moved around. They did remain four-unit buildings. How it has been, what they're going to call an as-built, what's existing, in Mr. Malasky's opinion, is an improved layout for life safety, but he still has an issue with the four-unit buildings. They're very large and very difficult to deal with in a fire, and there's also greater exposure for damage to multiple units. When Hillside was completed, the as-built plan was done, was finished, and that was all submitted, and that's a completed project now. So there is some precedence relative to the project of not going through a full site plan review. But again, they remained four units buildings, but the configuration was just a little different relative to the access in the road, and they put in a cul-de-sac. So the fire trucks could, have a better turn radius. So I just wanted to get that into the record because he did call me and said that he couldn't be here tonight, but that he thought the board should know that. Okay, discussion.
How has it been discussed as substantially different prior to this?
We actually didn't get into a discussion on how it's substantially different, other than we know that the original plan was the four-unit layout and a total of 54 units. And now we're going to have 52 units, but they'll be in the duplexes. Additionally, the other change, and I think it's a note in the applicant's material, is that in the existing approved plan layout, there was a lot of parking lot areas, and when we have the information here, this plan has a significantly less impervious surface coverage. They're not like creating these parking locations. Mm-hmm. The parking is going to be at the units and the streets. The applicant wants to add anything.
Yes, the difference between the old plan and the new is that pavement has been reduced by almost 51,000 square feet. The rooftops, even though there's more buildings, have been reduced by almost 20,000 square feet.
You mean the pavement has been reduced to 51,000 square feet? You said
correct.
By.
Excuse
okay.
me. Yes. Yes. Okay. I was reading what I was seeing.
Okay. I just want to make sure.
Yes, at the end of the day.
10,000 square foot reduction.
Correct. There's roughly 10,000 square feet of reduction.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And you got the grid, right, Adam? Okay. Elizabeth?
Yep. It's a very steep site in some places, it seems.
On the backside of some of the units, depending on how far into the hill, yes.
And I was just wondering, there's going to be quite amount of excavation then? And are you going to, how are you going to manage for stormwater on this site?
The stormwater is actually going to be brought up much closer, if not to today's standards, rather than what our intent is to...
Because that is a big shift.
Correct.
That focus is...
Correct.
Been on stormwater to be contained within the site.
Correct. We will be managing that to the, basically to today's standards.
Okay.
Is that required under the, your alteration of terrain permit through the state?
Yes, I believe Tim could speak to that on...
Regardless of how this board finds, you know, the grandfathering of the plan, the project still would have to go through state permitting, and the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services has a program called alteration of terrain. Anything that impacts more than 100,000 square feet has to go through that process. They've rewritten the rules for that entirely over the last few years, to the point where it's not just about managing the stormwater, detaining it so that the runoff after you've built the rooftops and the parking isn't any more than before. We have to do that, and that will all be done in a variety of different practices, but we also have to treat for quality, because the rain that falls on the rooftops is contaminated. The runoff that comes off of the parking areas is contaminated in even a different way. So we will have to meet those rules. We will have to have that permit, and that will all be done in a variety of, you know, underground infiltration systems, bioretention ponds, or rain garden is more, the more common term. And it's all about kind of keeping it broken up and not collecting it all in one spot.
One major detention pond.
Doing it in multiple areas to detain it and control the amounts, as well as to treat it and recharge it back into the ground.
Okay, thanks for clarifying that.
If we approve this plan, you'll come back with more clear or clearer plans than you're presenting to us so far?
We certainly could come back in.
This doesn't show where the fire extinguishers are going, other fire hydrants are going to be, et cetera.
Yes, we could absolutely come back in with a much more defined plan as to locations of fire hydrants and
lights, if you're going to have them, et cetera.
We are going to try to maintain similar, more of a dark field based on what else is out there. We don't want to create a big airport, so to speak. And so we absolutely, once we get to that stage, we have no problem bringing in a much more defined plan to...
The plan that was submitted to the state will, you know, have much more information in order to get that permit. And everything we submit to the state by regulation has to be submitted to the town.
Okay.
I think with the changing of the impervious surfaces, removing some of those parking lot areas, it's not very clear as to visitor parking. You know, living over on Hillside Lane in the four unit buildings, we do have visitor parking, and the impervious surface areas that you talked about in the, you know, off to the side of each of the driveways, just thinking, you know, snow removal, life safety during that time of the year, it may be kind of tricky. So I guess I think I'd like to see it laid out a little bit better. That would be a concern, I think, is that additional parking. But that's the only thing that really jumps out at me.
Thank you. But still, are these things that are big enough that we would consider them substantially different for us to be even able to ask all of those questions?
Right. The decision that we make to need to make is, if we're determining the proposal concept is substantially different, if we determine that it is, the applicant needs to go through a new site plan review.
Right.
This would fall under major only because of our regulations. It doesn't fall under minor. And we would have the ability to waive various sections of major site plan review. If we determine that this concept, as far as laying out the development, is not substantially different, then they don't, the applicant doesn't have to go through the whole site plan review process.
I mean, it's not necessarily, you know, going through the process. I mean, we have to go through the whole state process and all of that.
Right, the approvals process at this level.
The issue is the change of zoning. I mean, zoning's different than it was when this plan was approved. So if this board finds that it is substantially different, essentially what that says to us is we have to go back to the four-unit building. And like you heard from the fire chief, a four-unit building is a lot harder for them to protect. They don't have as much access as they do in the smaller units. And it's harder for us to do some of the things that we want to do to make the development green. So.
Sure.
Well, really,
and my thought was, I mean, quite a bit has been presented to us already. We just referenced the question of substantially different, and to me, I don't see where that, yeah. I don't see that it is. So.
Can we? Sorry.
Yeah. Discussion. I'm sorry. So are you finished, Adam?
I am.
So,
okay. Excuse me. I just is this potentially maybe mislabeled in terms of the number of units that are on
5-4? Is that the newest one? 12.
We actually reduced the number of units by 2.
Okay, because most of these buildings say 4 units. There's only one that says 3 units.
I think you're looking at the old plan. You're looking at the approved plan.
But it's dated 5-4-12. That's why I'm asking.
If I can, the original plan actually had 55 units on it.
Okay.
Yeah. But the board met in 90-whatever. I think it was changed to 54 units.
Okay, it just says this date says 5-4-12.
Would
you like to look at that?
Yeah, we just digitized the other plans so there was like a cleaner copy.
Just did that on 5-4.
Right.
Okay, I just want to make sure that is not representative of what you're proposing.
This is what's physically in the old, this is this plan.
Okay, it's the date that was confusing me.
Yeah. I digitized this plan on that date.
Okay, but it just, when it says the date,
right.
I should have made the note reference this date.
That would be, yeah. Have been helpful.
I'm the one that was responsible for.
No, that's okay, but I just want to, you can see why I'd want to clarify that.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, that would be, whether or not, is that substantially different than that?
But I just want to make sure.
Yeah, that's a good question. Any other comments?
We need to look at the floodplain.
If this is determined to be substantially different, then the applicant has to go through the start of the whole process.
Okay.
Any other comments, discussion?
Just throwing out the suggestion that I think that there is no need to be quite so linear in terms of potentially the arrangement of this. I mean, it's a new design opportunity, perhaps, to think about that.
And two-dimensionally, it looks more linear, but the third dimension is that the slope of the land is from the bottom of the page to the top, and so the units will actually have a vertical difference that will help with.
Okay, it's but, just, but, I just, know, you may want to arrange for a more
you had made the
aesthetic,
well,
sort of arrangement. You don't have to be married to your original alignments.
Yes, well, we were trying to increase our buffer zones, and we were trying to work much more with the existing terrain to minimize the amount of excavation. That's why we've located it the way we have.
It just looks to me, I'm just speaking from the point of view of trying to keep within the context of sort of the countryside of Newmarket. To me, this is a more formal town sort of layout. It's just a thought.
So are we looking for a
motion? Do I hear a motion?
I'll make a motion
that the CRC Future Corp's request for a modification of the final subdivision and site plan approved on 2/24/87 at Doral Wood, tax map R5, lot 132, R2 zone, to allow the reconfiguration of lot 132, an 8.9-acre lot, from 13 four-unit buildings and 1 2-unit building to a total of 54 units, to 26 duplex units, a total of 52 units, and it does not constitute a substantially different plan from the original approval, which would require the applicant submit a new plan for site review based on the following findings of fact. Should I read these down here, too?
You want to read those and then these?
One, you will provide a detailed plan that's equivalent to the state plan that you're going to provide. Two, question, you'll provide us an answer on additional parking. And further, the as-built site plan, when the project is completed, is consistent with the state plan, with the site plan submitted under the design review hearing. Two, representations made by the applicant during these deliberations are incorporated into the final as-built site plan. Three, the town public works and fire chief provide a written statement of support to the planning department that the proposed revisions do not create any additional impact on the public safety or public services as compared to the approved design concept. Four, a copy of all required state and federal permits and any corresponding drainage reports and or engineering plans are provided to the planning department prior to the start of construction. And five, the Newmarket Code Enforcement Officer also determined the proposed design is not substantially different than the approved plan.
Do you have any questions?
I actually have I received this today. This is a letter from the police chief. I don't think I have enough copies for everybody, but after our last meeting, I had made appointments to meet with both the fire chief and the police chief to have them under their professional ability review the sites and give us their opinion as to how the sites are improved or not improved. And so those letters, I believe Rick has already commented to you verbally.
I think this would be to have something in writing from Public Works and the Fire Department.
Okay.
Your motion also mentioned the code enforcement officer, and Walt tried to have the same conversation with her, but she was not willing to discuss the project. So
planning board?
Yeah, she's just simply waiting.
Relative to the attorney's letter, it requires the planning board and the code enforcement officer.
Correct.
So I think that's why that condition.
So at this point, she'll be happy to discuss it.
She should be.
Need a second.
I'll second that.
Second by Justin. Any discussion on the motion or the conditions of, it's not an approval, it's the conditions of the determination?
Just have a question. The units are going to be 1, 2, 3, 4 bedrooms?
There's going to be a combination of three. There might be a few 4 bedrooms based on how the elevations will allow us to work with them. But on average, there'll
be at least three?
More than likely.
Yep. And the current approval has no bedroom restrictions?
No.
If there's no further, I'm sorry, Jean?
No.
Okay, if there's no further discussion, I will move the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstaining? Okay. Don't need to come before us again.
Okay.
Unless the code enforcement officer is stating you do.
Okay. I will make it a point to see her and we'll move forward. Thank you very much.
And if you can get Diane, though, the plan.
Sure.
She'll have to submit anyway the code enforcement. She'll share that with the board.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Okay. Next on the agenda. Is the Russell C. Serbagi, Jr. at Katie Engineers and Constructors. Okay. Yeah, that's good.
I received a call around 5:30 tonight. He tried to get to the town hall, and of course, the town hall was closed. Mm-hmm. Then he tried to get to call you, he said, and
probably
couldn't
call
get,
my house.
Probably. And for some reason, he ended up calling my house, and he is not going to be here tonight.
Okay.
He was not sure that he didn't know he was supposed to be here.
I would like to have a, I think we should continue this hearing. Can I have a motion to continue the hearing?
Make a motion to approve the Russell C. Sabagi Jr. KD Engineering Construction continuation of the public hearing for the application until the July meeting.
Is there a second to the motion?
Okay.
Just relative to discussion, the planning, I don't know where the applicant is at this time, so hopefully he'll either meet with Diane before the next meeting or at least come before us at the next meeting with what direction he needs to go in. I think our decision, based upon the variance, we would first need to decide whether or not the plan is being that has been submitted and the application has already been accepted by the board, the application, whether or not we can act on that relative to the zoning board variance that was granted. And we've all have additional information now on that. So at the next meeting, unless something happens, in between then, we'll definitely take that up for discussion. But I think the applicant should obviously be here for that.
Is there anything we can discuss today to help move it along for them?
I don't know. The applicant has requested that, through the phone call that this be continued. So I don't believe that we should be deliberating on it or hearing public comments on it without the applicant present. And I'm sorry, I know that we have some people here. And certainly, any abutters or any interested parties, if you have comments, feel free to forward them to the town planner.
What's the date of the meeting in July?
Good question. So that would be continued. And can you amend the motion? We do need to continue it to a date certain. It's going to be July 10th.
July 10th, 2012.
Thank you.
Whoever seconded that was okay with the friendly amendment?
Yes.
Okay. So, all those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
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 Anyone not in favor? Okay, motion passes. Next on the agenda, a public hearing to consider the issuance of an order based on a report by the Town of Newmarket's engineer, Vanessa and Associates, under RSA 23613. Vanessa and Associates performed a site distance evaluation on the intersection of Grant Road and Fox Hollow and recommends action be taken to achieve an acceptable safety condition at this intersection. The report concludes the necessary stopping site distance and intersection site distance are currently not provided at that intersection. Under the statute, the Planning Board is authorized to issue an order which, I'll quote, shall describe the hazard, prescribe what corrective action or alteration and the location or configuration of such access shall be required, and set a reasonable time within which the action shall be completed, end quote. The statute also provides, in quotes, the owner or other responsible party shall be civilly liable to the state or municipality for its costs in taking such action, end quote. This was forwarded to us at the request of the town council. It is the RSA, which requires the Planning Board to take action. Or to not take action. I'm assuming most people here that are remaining are here for this application. Up here on the table, we have the RSA. If anyone has not received, if anyone hasn't looked that up or needs a copy of that, and we also have the Vanessa engineering report. So those are up here. And I also had the planning office pull the approved plan, which is here as well. So,
I
like slack. We printed it up on. The layout of the, as it is right now, correct?
That is the, we don't know, because we've never, we'll get into that. That is the approved subdivision plan, that is how it should have been built and what the requirements are.
Okay.
So, there are relative to, relative to the advice of council, town council, our legal counsel, we really have, I think, two issues that we may want to deliberate on. The first is, and I'm quoting for the benefit of the public, and obviously folks that are here, this is the March 6th memo from our attorney, Justin Richardson. The first issue has to do with this RSA, that a planning board shall retain continuing jurisdiction over the adequacy and safety of every existing driveway, entrance, exit, and approach to a highway, whether or not such access was constructed or installed pursuant to a permit under this section. This statute applies to private roads such as Fox Hollow, as well as to traditional driveways. Under the statute, the planning board is authorized to issue an order which shall describe the hazard, prescribe the corrective action, everything that was read earlier. Our attorney has gone on to state that based on the evidence presented, the planning board could then vote to order that the necessary improvements be completed as appropriate. And this may precipitate the Fox Hollow Homeowners Association or its residents to consider their own claims based on what appears to be a defective design of the road, as the engineer's report has submitted. The second issue here, in a letter dated on June 8th, is basically a repetition of the March information. But the planning board may also, in its discretion, consider whether to recommend that the town council accept or lay out Fox Hollow as a town road, but we're not required to do so. So I'd like to at least this evening, start discussion on both of those issues, and I think we should start with the RSA issue, because that's been requested of us by the town council.
Okay, so can you show again what you were reading from the March
on the March
memo?
Which
page?
That's from page 3. In that memo, I mean, obviously, it goes into all the background of the subdivision, the declaration of the covenants, talks about the homeowners associations, the private road status, who's going to maintain it, the performance bond for completion, the issue of the performance bond, no longer being there.
And
so that was page 3.
Page 3 of the March memo.
Correct.
Okay, and I must
driveway permit modification.
And I'm just I couldn't find exactly where.
And if you go, it's actually repeated on page 2 of the June. I'm sorry, this is double copied. Page 3 of the June 8th.
Yes, that I found.
Yeah, so that's okay. Just a repetition of
okay.
What was in the
okay,
March
I just wanted to make memory. Sure that was exactly what we were first discussing. Exactly. Okay.
So before I open up to public comments, is there any kind of questions from the board procedurally or?
So just for me to understand, the first part of this analysis is you're asking us to agree that this is within our jurisdiction, as you're asking us to say, yes, this is within our jurisdiction. Is that what you're
asking
of us?
We're being told that
it
under
is.
The RSA,
okay,
the planning board needs to either
take
action or we either need to agree with the town engineer's report that there is a, you know, relative to the adequacy and safety of this private road. So we either need to provide the notice to comply with the recommendations of the town engineer, unless we want to make different recommendations, or we need to conclude that we do not agree with the town engineer. you know, it's going to be based upon any of the facts that are presented.
Okay, I wasn't sure what you were asking from us. Okay, thank you.
That would be the first.
Okay.
So we do this in two stages?
We should do it in two stages, because we should really act on the RSA. That's what the notice was.
And then decide whether or not it's a town road.
And then we have the ability to make a recommendation to the town council, because the town council actually accepts roads.
If we want to do that, and we can decide that later.
Or they can do that. The owners, the owners down there can petition the town.
Okay.
So by way of just the history here, when a development is actually approved, which are these plans, what happens is a bond is typically posted for completion of the road, and then the developer has to provide an as-built plan to the town, and then it's to, and then the engineer, the town engineer reviews that to determine whether or not the as-built plan matches what was approved. So that would have happened years ago had that been done. An as-built plan was never provided to the town. So that's one part of it. To accept a subdivision road as a town road, it then needs to go before the developer or the homeowners need to petition the town council, not attorney, the actual town eds group, the town council. They have to petition the town council to accept that road.
Okay.
And the town council will determine whether or not they want to accept the road or that it gets maintained as a private road in perpetuity.
Okay. So is that issue here truly, it's a question of cost, as it often is? In terms of I think all of those people who have gone to the site see that it is a dangerous, I believe, for one, it's a dangerous intersection. So is that what, are we, in essence, really determining who, if anyone, will be paying?
No, we have nothing to do with that.
Town road versus private road.
Correct. Our notice is to the owner of the road, which is under deed Long Cove. I'm not sure if any representative is here from the developer. The developer still owns the road.
Okay.
It's never been deeded to, certainly to the town.
Okay.
There's no deed on record that's been deeded to the association. So the developer still owns the road. So the notice goes to the owner or other responsible party. The responsible party relative to our town legal counsel's analysis of all of the documentation is the covenants, the deeds to the property, to all the owners, state that it's a private road. Their deeds also state that their acceptance of the property is subject to their membership in the association and the rules and the regulations and obligations and responsibility of the association. So as a responsible party, because it could be determined that the association's responsible. But that's not in our purview. That is a legal question.
Okay.
That when the notice is given, if that, and that's why he specifically put in here, let me read that again. This may also precipitate the Fox Hollow Homeowners Association or its residents to consider their own claims based on what appears to be a defective design of the road. The town legal counsel is saying that if in fact it falls on the homeowners to correct this deficiency, or if the town chooses to correct it and then build the association because the developer is bankrupt, if that's the process, then the owners could have a claim, is what the legal counsel is saying.
I do have a
but it's not our, we don't decide that.
I do have a procedural question. I couldn't really tell with these documents if the town is able to adopt only a portion of the road as opposed to the entire road.
No, you're accepting the road itself. So everything is that's on the plan in the public way.
Mm-hmm.
May I ask another question?
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps I missed a comparison, but has a comparison been made between the approved plan and the as-built?
No, that's good. I should expand on that. There is no as-built plan.
But there would
have to be an as-built plan submitted and reviewed by the town's engineer for compliance before the town council could deliberate on accepting the road.
And that's not a new requirement at the time of
No, that's, and that's, in fact, if you go into the documentation relative to the conditions of approval.
So it sounds to me like there was a critical step skipped.
Correct, the developer never fulfilled the conditions of the approval, if in fact they wanted to turn it over as a town road.
And the developer is no longer in the picture?
We only know that we sent out the notice and it was returned, so the obligation of the town to send out the notice has been fulfilled. So, and I'm sure they'll try to track that down more, because it was also Biltmore, is another entity that may be responsible.
But.
Just as a follow-up question to that, may I ask, so has the engineer looked at it in terms of roughly?
Nothing has been done on this for many, many years.
Okay, I wasn't sure if the engineer actually gone off to the site and compared in any fashion the approved plan with the actual circumstances.
No, the town's engineer, and I don't know what precipitated this, the Vaness, the town council must have hired Vaness to go out and determine the safety and adequacy of the private road relative to the egress and ingress off of Grant Road. Whether or not that was precipitated by someone who uses Grant Road or the homeowners who, you know, have a concern, and I'll open it up in a minute, that came before the town council. The action was taken to investigate that. The town engineer said, yeah, there's a problem here, is what, you know, the engineering report relates to, has made recommendations for how to correct it. And then, and so now the town, because under the RSA, the planning board needs to act on that. Because the town council has requested us to.
Procedurally, as we just described it, it sounded as though either prescription the planning board comes to tonight is going to require a cost on the part of the homeowner or the home or the developer either way, I guess, though, huh? Either in the form of the finished site plan or in the form of correcting the problems.
That's correct. If the planning board is going to vote to give the notice,
mm-hmm.
If the planning board votes that we do not deem it to be after hearing all the testimony in our deliberations, If the vote of the board is that we do not agree that there is a safety or adequacy issue, then we would be voting to not provide the notice. So our vote tonight is to provide a notice or to not provide a notice.
Or to provide a recommendation to the
second
town.
As a second item.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Everyone set here? Okay, and if any people who are going to speak have questions about what we've just discussed, please feel free to ask. So with that, I will open the podium for public comments. Would anyone from the public care to speak? And if you would please state your name and your address for the record.
Good evening, folks. My name is Steve Wheeler. I am Fox Hollow, number 4, the first house on the right. I represent the Homeowners Association as the president. I believe you have a letter from Vic Bilodeau that you're going to...
Yeah, I'll read that in. Would you like to read it into the record?
No, I thought it was going to be read into the record.
We'll read it into the record, definitely.
Okay. The position in Vic's letter, I think, is echoed by all the homeowners. Obviously, over the years, we've talked about the intersection, and I think it's been, 7 years since... Beth Levenstein has been after the town to do something about it. They put up that mirror that's just to the west of Fox Hollow to help see traffic coming from the west, but I think it was only 3 or 4 months that the mirror was up there, then someone decided to throw something at it and break it. So the mirror's never been replaced since it's been broke. A couple years ago, Vic took over the spearheading the campaign to try to get something done with the intersection. And we appreciate the fact that the town went and did their own engineering study and there was a problem found, but you really don't need to be an engineer or a rocket scientist or even stay at a Holiday Inn Express last night to figure out that you drive in and out of that 6 times and you're going to realize there's a problem there. Because if you drive in and out of there 6 times, more than likely one of those times you're almost going to get hit because of the configuration. Not of actually Fox Hollow, but it's actually of Grant Road. There's actually a rise in the road of Grant Road right at Fox Hollow that creates the problem. So, and it was actually news to myself that I just found out Monday that Fox Hollow was not a town road. The town has been plowing that road since we moved in. We were the first ones to move in December of 2004. And ever since we've been living there, the town has been plowing the road, and the town put up speed limit signs at the beginning of the road. It was my understanding that the town had taken over the road. So that was a surprise to me, and I'm sure a surprise to the rest of the homeowners that the town didn't take the road over. So I guess our questions would be, what action, as far as fixing the problem, would the planning board recommend for that site?
Any comments?
Well, I think that surely Grant Road was there before Fox Hollow Road, so I don't think you can fault Grant Road for its current configuration. I think the question is going to be surely that it was not adequately designed by the developer.
Oh, I agree with that, but on the other hand, Town Planning Board back in 2003 approved the plan and allowed the development to go
ahead. I understand, and I think that's one of the steps that we're going to discuss tonight is how we can, first of all, see what differences, if any, were made between the actual construction of the site and as it was approved by the town. I for one, feel that that's going to be important.
Has he had an opportunity to see the engineer's report?
The engineer's report is here. So
there are prescriptions. Yeah. Listed there.
Okay. You mentioned that the developer still has a bond with the town for that. Do you have any idea how much that bond is?
It is unclear. Let me rephrase that. The town's legal counsel believes that bond is no longer in effect. It was an automatic renewal bond for 1 year. Because you pay for a bond ahead of time. And that bond was renewed for a 1 year period.
That's why I wanted two stages, because it has questions on the bond that we have to look into. Okay.
Well, I think that's going to, I think, get into the next discussion. Okay. I'll assume you just asked that question because we don't have any name or address. Okay. Yep.
I don't think it was a question. Okay. She was just stating that when the... Okay.
Well, the planning required posting of the subdivision performance bond was September 30th, 2004, and that was to secure compliance with the board's notice of the decision. And the bond provided for an initial term of 1 year, and it stated, which shall automatically renew for a period of 1 year, and if the improvements covered by the instrument are not completed, and a letter from the planning board or its designee had not been issued, stating that the required improvements have been completed in a manner consistent with the board's approval, then the instrument shall remain in full force and effect. So the bond has not been released. Okay. However, the bond is at best unclear as to whether it was intended to automatically renew for successive 1 year periods or if it simply expired after a single 1 year renewal period. The question is a difficult one, but I believe the better interpretation is the bond lapsed after a single renewal period on September 30th, 06. This is coming from Attorney Richardson's letter. He has an additional factor to consider is that the bond only secured completion of the improvements required by the approved plans in notice of decision. It's my understanding that those improvements were completed, but that the design that was approved is inadequate. So based on the foregoing, he does not recommend the town seek to enforce the bond. The situation becomes that and we don't know because we don't have an as-built plan. The developer. There's a whole list of things the developer has to do relative to the notice of the decision. and prior to start of construction, prior to issuing occupancy permits, et cetera. In some of what, and it's okay to have a private road. This wasn't, there's definitely documentation, and even in your association documents, that reference, you know, the fact that it's a private road. So, you know, that's, you know, all in the documents. But the question being is, relative to this bond, that the improvements were completed.
They were adequate.
Right. The issue is, was what the developer did inadequate? So that's the issue at hand, and subsequently why we're here tonight.
Well, I mean, once the road was built, they didn't do anything. The road was built, and it was never changed or modified in any way. Where it was put is where it still is right now. So I don't know if they ever made any efforts to do anything to it.
But I think the question is, was it properly constructed? And that is, if so, I think part of what we as the planning board are looking to see is if where the responsibility lies for correcting the issue. And if we
actually don't have that authority.
Oh, okay.
The only authority we have is to
see, first of all, see
if we agree that it's safe and there's an adequacy issue, to issue the notice.
Yes.
And under the RSA, the notice goes to the landowner or other responsible party. So that's one action that we have the authority to take.
Okay.
And we also have the authority to recommend to the town council whether or not they accept a subdivision, a private road.
Sure. Okay,
to be a public road.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Right. I understand.
Yeah. So we have no authority here to say, hey, you know, town made a mistake, you know,
well,
town
council will spend the
money.
Okay.
That's a town council issue.
But I think that will be part of this evaluation, I would gather.
I think the owners out here would definitely, I see that going to the town council. I just want to be clear that...
We're not the body for that. It's the town council.
Yeah.
But I, for one, would like to say also that since we're agreeing about the first part of that, you were asking us to assess of whether it's a safety issue. Mm-hmm. I went out there and I took my heart in my hand to take a left.
Mm-hmm.
So. Let's
continue with public comments, and then the board will deliberate.
Sure. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Well, seeing how it's narrowed down to that, I mean, a lot of our questions, I think, were who's responsible for the actions. But seeing how we're focused on the safety of it, I guess, going back to Vic Bilodeau's letter, that it echoes, I think, the sentiments of all the neighbors that, like I said, all you got to do is go out there, drive in and out of there a few times, and it is a dangerous intersection. So that's our feeling on the position. And anybody else want to say a few words? I'll let you.
Okay. Please. And again, name and address for the record.
My name is John Nisa, and I'm the number 8 Fox Hollow.
I'm sorry, John.
John Nisa, NICR, 8 Fox Hollow. If I want to boil it down, we're going to be looking at, you know, whether the road is 3 inches to the left or the right that it was built, to determine, you know, and that will take some time. And at the end of the day, it is a question of responsibility. But the responsibility is not that of who's going to pay. The responsibility is that of lives and time. So every day we wait, and every hurdle we put in place is an additional responsibility we all have in terms of potentially somebody getting hurt. You know, we were saying when we were walking in, we found it unbelievably lucky, touch wood, that nobody's got hurt in the time that road has been there. I mean, we've all experienced the close shaves and all that stuff. And, you know, some families have got young adults that are driving for the first time and they don't have the experience, and you know, those are dangerous situations. So I do think that those recommendations are linked, because if you recommend, and the feeling I've got is everybody is in agreement that it is dangerous, but then you don't recommend it becomes a town road, we're going to be here for another 2 or 3 years arguing as to, was it 3 inches that way, was it 3 inches that way, where is the developer, and all that bit. And I think that if we do that, then we really have a problem. So if, you know.
Let me just clarify that from a time perspective. The notice of the decision relative to the issuance of that will have is required to have a time period on it for the improvements to be corrected or implemented, failing which the town will make the improvements and bill the responsible party.
Right.
Okay. So they definitely will be, if we do vote to provide the notice that it's, you know, not safe or inadequate or not adequate, we'll have to come up with a time period for that to be corrected. And if it's not corrected, then the town has to step in to do that.
And the time period is also something which needs to be addressed. One of our members suggested that there would be a three-way stop be put in place in between the time that the modifications are made and that, you know, and now. And, you know, it seems a pretty preposterous idea, but at the end of the day, if that's going to save a life, and, you know, if it's three-way stop is there for 6 months, well, it's there for 6 months, and that may be a solution that would actually sort of prevent something bad happening. And once I've said this in public, it's said, you know, and, okay. And I think, you know, it's something which has to be taken into consideration. The time period, it's not going to be done straight away, whatever we say, you know, whatever. I mean, it needs engineering work, it needs planning work, it needs, you know, so there is a problem. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you
for may I ask a question before?
A question?
Yes. Well, in terms of your sense of urgency, I just wonder how long you've been there and how long this has been a known problem. I mean, for us, this has just landed on our desk, so we haven't been intending to drag our feet.
No, I'm not. I'm not suggesting that.
I agree that there could be some intermediary measures, for example, but
I'm not suggesting this okay. board is in any way dragging their feet. I think that once it's on the table, that's, you know, and from our perspective, we've been living with it for 7 years or plus. So, you know, and we've been knocking on different doors to get this done. And as Steve said, I mean, we were under the impression, I mean, we see police cars going to and fro in the private road. We see snow removal. We see the signage has been put up by the town. We have every evidence in our mind to think that this is a public road, right? I mean, there's no reason why a cruiser would go around a private road. You know, I mean, in our mind, it is that. And it was sort of definitely sold us that way to us. So, I mean, but that's a different issue.
I have a question for you. Thank you. The concern, though, that I have for, or one of the concerns that I have for this group is, if we were to issue the order, I suppose there is a risk that the expense for fixing the issue falls on this group. I don't know that it would, but I think that there's like a risk of that. And I don't know if that risk is worth it. I don't know if that risk is, worth it. I don't know that I can't determine how great a risk it is, but I mean, it would seem that if the town council didn't decide to take the road on as a town road, that then having determined that the road is unsafe, somebody has to fix it, and it sounds like with the developer gone, that would fall on the homeowners association.
Well, according to what she said, that the developer still owns it.
Yeah.
Correct.
So we don't even own it.
Right.
We don't own the road. We didn't approve the plans.
Right.
I don't see how any way that it hold the homeowners responsible.
Okay.
We're working on the assumption that these plans don't correspond to the reality, the as-built. We have no idea, but we're working on the worst-case scenario there of saying those plans don't correspond to the as-built, and therefore, you know, this is why I say that this would take time, because, I mean, this would become, you know, a situation where we would obviously turn around and say it's not ours. We would then be running around looking for an owner who's somewhere in Florida, as I understand. You know, I mean,
sure. And I'm just asking that question in your guys' interest.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
Because that is the situation from Attorney Justice's position, is that if the developer still holds the deed, but if the developer has gone bankrupt, then is the legal question that the title to the property is somehow now under the ownership of the homeowners? Because within all the documents, it talks about the private road for the use of the homeowners. It's in your deeds, it's in your covenants, and it talks about the responsibility of the association for the maintenance of the association property. That's a whole, I understand it's a real issue, who pays, but that it's going to be a separate issue to be dealt with if the developer doesn't come forward and the town has to step in and do the work. It's, you know, if the town council is going to elect to do the work and then move it forward for reimbursement under the state statute, that will be a town council decision.
So I thought you brought up an interesting point about signage, mm-hmm. and that could be, you know, something that we might recommend be put in place as soon as possible, for example, until things get settled. I think that's an interesting idea. I'm just noting that.
Yeah, no, we'll deliberate on those. Okay. But just to answer the
I think you're
public
right.
question.
It opens a Pandora box. Mm-hmm. But we're working on the worst case scenario. It may be that we find that that plan
sure.
is accurate. And then, you know, then the problem sort of fades away. I mean, it doesn't fade away, but I mean the actual responsibility fades away, because then it's clearly it was approved that way, it was built that way, it's not right, it's got to be fixed. But that's a different scenario.
Okay, thank you so much.
Excuse me if I may.
Using Jean.
The toy. It shows that the developer is still viable when you do a search on the name. That they are viable, that they're still in Greenland. And then the last question, I'm sorry?
Biltmore is in Greenland.
Yeah.
Yeah, the owner of the road is Long
Cove. Long Cove Developers, Greenland, New Hampshire. And then it's, ironically enough, it says credibility review. So I thought that was kind of interesting. Last question is, if they owned the road, would they have paid taxes on the road?
No, and I had that discussion with the assessor also. Okay. You know, are you taxed different because you're on a private road versus public road? In the state of New Hampshire, all property taxes are based on market value. So anyone purchasing a property, regardless of what road you live on, you know, the purchase is you know, how are they determining market value? So it's the same whether or not it has a view or your waterfront. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, what are the indications?
So we don't think that the developer would have paid taxes on owning that physical road?
No.
Okay.
No, I would know that would be, they don't, it's not like a lot that you can convey.
I'm just thinking of obtaining an address, that's all.
No, and Newmarket doesn't assess taxes on common land either. They have made that decision. It's part of your market value, your ownership in these other amenities. But I did follow up on that because I had the same question. Mm-hmm. Any other comments from the public? Yes.
Sue Pingree, 314 Grant Road.
314 Grant Road, and I'm
directly across the street.
And I'm sorry, your name again?
Sue Pingree.
Sue Pingree. Thank you.
I just kind of wanted to speak on what you said about you didn't quite the urgency of all this, and you just got this notice. My driver used to be directly across the street. I told the town when all this came up not to put the road there. I moved my driveway because it was much, much too dangerous. And I spoke to the planning board. I said, don't put the road there. It's much too dangerous. You need to move it one way or the other because of that dip that's right there. And they just totally ignored whatever I had to say. So it has been an issue before their road even went in. And so I really think something should be done about it because it's much too dangerous.
I agree, it's dangerous. I was just referring to the fact that this planning board has just received this.
No, yeah, I realize that, but I mean, these guys are, they have to live in there.
Sure.
I moved my driveway. Mm-hmm.
I had two that were sort of like on either side of that, and it was just, it's way too much, too much. And then all the extra cars and the kids, and, you know, somebody came by up over that hill much too fast the other day and took out one of my chickens.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's just a chicken, but still, it could have been a child walking across the street. Because they come, everyone also goes much, much too fast on that road. No one follows that speed limit. Mm-hmm. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions from the public?
Sure.
Yes.
My name is Rob Levitt. I'm from 323 Grant Road. I'm in a butter. So this is minimal impact on my property. But to Steve's point about the Grant Road leading up the hill to Fox Hollow, having driven through there thousands of times, it's clearly evident that without seeing the engineer's recommendation, the town engineer's recommendation, I would assume that this might end up affecting Grant Road itself. And if that's the case, I'd just like to be on record as requesting that the town council really take a good look at the entire intersection as well. We have a flood zone culvert crossing just before that hill, and then it swings in two different directions before it crests up and over the hill. And if the minimum required feet is 130 as opposed to 260, I think you're going to have to pick up quite a bit of feet for that to happen, which might include Grant Road. So I'd just like to express a want to take a look at the entire Grant Road area in that spot there, okay? And for life safety purposes, and I know this is more of the town council and DPW, I'd like to also see a dry hydrant potentially installed in the little beaver pond that's in that location, because none of us have a hydrant within 1,000 feet of our house, okay? So, and that has an effect on our insurance policies, fire insurance policies. We have to depend on the town to be able to race out there and do something about any fire hazards, okay? Where there's a permanent watershed right there to be tapped into, okay? That's
Thank all. You very much.
Thanks.
Any other comments?
Greg Thayer, 332 Grant Road. I did the site walk when that development went in, and one of the big issues that came up in the site walk was where that road was going to come out. I believe also there was some property traded between one of the neighbors and the developer to kind of make sure that the neighbor kept their blueberry bushes and some other things that were actually on the Fox Run Hollow land. And so there was some changes in the frontage of that property, and that's probably back in your record, you would have that information.
Yep.
But I remember that was the big issue during the site walk, was the entrance to the Grant Road. So right from the get-go, it was an issue. Thank you.
Thank you.
And by the way, the speed limits they're saying on that thing is wrong. Those cars go faster than that, let me tell you.
I think it's an extension of the limit.
Yeah. Cars go faster everywhere.
Okay. Anyone else before I close public comments?
Well, all these comments really go back to this problem.
If you can come up to the podium, please, particularly because we have the audience listening at home.
Whether we figure that this, whether the as-built comes in as right or wrong, it's not completely wrong. You know what I mean? It's not going to be 20 feet one way or the other. If the as-built, if we do that, I would suspect, looking at the plan, that we're going to be 1 or 2 feet out or something like that. You know, it's not going to be completely different to what is there. And so, basically, we're in front of a situation where the previous planning permission that was done years ago was hastily done and may have had some flaws in it, and we're trying to correct it now. That's really what we're trying to do. And I think we're trying to correct it with with the minimum impact on everybody who's living there right now.
So, thank you.
Any questions?
No, but I'll just clarify from the relative to the RSA. This RSA applies not just to a private road; it applies to a driveway. So if the planning board finds that even a driveway accessing a public road is deemed to be unsafe or not adequate, is the wording, the planning board could issue the same notice to any individual owner.
With respect, if it was built according to planning board's requirements.
That, according to the RSA and our town's attorney's opinion, the town is not held liable for the representations of the developer or the developer's engineering reports. They're just, they're reviewed by the town, but there's no liability on the town. There's case law relative to that, and that's the opinion. And not that it's not fair. It's just, unfortunately, that's the actual law.
You're telling me then that the town can approve something that's unsafe and then not be responsible for making it safe?
According to the town's legal counsel, yes.
Right.
We're not saying that.
It would be interesting.
We're saying don't shoot the messenger up here. That is in fact the law.
Right.
Yeah. No different than issuing someone a driveway permit when they build their house. And then 10 years later, because who knows, maybe if you look at your easement areas, maybe all the vegetation was cleared and it wasn't a problem 10 years. I'm not saying this particular case. But now all of a sudden the vegetation grows up and the town comes in and says, hey, you need to cut that back. I mean, as an example.
Yes, yes. Okay.
I think there are copies there for you to look at that might be helpful. Of the attorney's letter?
No, the attorney's letter is not there.
Oh,
if anyone would like a copy of any of the legal correspondence, please just
ask
Sue or Diane at the town.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
We'd be informative.
Yeah, well, and definitely you should have all of that. Okay. Anyone else? Okay. I am going to close public comments at 8:20. So let's deliberate this in two stages. The first is the issue of the RSA and the notice, and whether or not the board agrees with the testimony that's been given that this is not safe or not adequate from everyone who's gone out there, anyone's own personal opinion, and then again if we agree with the town engineer's review, I think that would be the first stage. Then if, in fact, we are in agreement that the relative to a notice, if we would concur with the remedy provided by the town engineer's recommendations, and then, or something else, and then what kind of time period that would be. Does that make sense? So right now, I would like to hear discussion from the members of the board here on this safety and adequacy issue. Rick?
I went out and looked at it and drove into the property and drove out, almost getting hit by a car as well. So I understand what you're talking about. I drove down Grant Road in both directions and came back. I noticed that there is no turn sign on the side coming from the town going into your property. So there is no turn sign there. And I don't know what happened to it. I don't know if it was ever put up or what, but I noticed that was missing. The second thing was that, you're right, I agreed, the mirror was broken. And even with the mirror, I don't know what you could see. So,
Council, please stop before you turn.
Well,
it helps mostly at night.
Public hearing is closed, yeah. And I'm just talking to the board, really, but I just wanted to tell you how I felt. So,
So your position is that you agree it's not safe and adequate and action should be taken?
I agree.
Okay. I'm in agreement, definitely. And I thought that the comment about the temporary solutions, stop sign, I thought that was a very bright and great short-term solution, if not longer than short-term. Because it's no secret that the speed limits are not followed out there. And it can be quite dangerous, so I'm in full agreement.
I agree with Justin on both of his points, although I do have two other points to add. The first is, just given the tax climate in town right now, it is a risk that our later decisions, you know, may not follow as favorably in terms of cost for the homeowners over there. That it just has to be taken into consideration. The second point, too, is generally with these kinds of questions, it's really difficult to go back and retroactively apply an order of this kind. It's not, I don't think, to be taken lightly. But I have, even in Highway Safety Commission meetings that I've sat in on or seen agendas for, heard about this issue previously over the last couple of years. It does seem to be dangerous.
Jane, any comments?
No, thank you.
Ed?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, definitely a hazard out there. Has safety hazard. Maybe speed bumps until it's cured. I mean, not cured, but until some decision is made. Maybe speed bumps out there. The cars are going pretty fast. So there's stop signs, speed bumps. But somebody should probably speak to Rick, Department of Public Works, see what we can do something about it.
I'm just concerned about that because and with the stop sign.
Listen, I don't want to have their turn.
I'm sorry.
Thanks. Melissa, Ed?
Yes.
Okay. So you're in agreement, the safety inadequacy issue?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
Elizabeth?
I reiterate my earlier comment that I was reluctant to take a left coming out. And there, I think an interim signage, and I would want to protect the safety of everyone in Newmarket. And I agree that something, a short-term measure, I would recommend some measure that could happen as soon as possible to help that with some sort of signage, even a hidden driveway signage or the stop sign or something like that. But I think care should be given to some immediate alert for that intersection myself.
Yes.
I call it Daytona Highway. It's a speed trap, not a speed trap, I mean a death trap. I feel there's a lot of other places in Newmarket who have the same problem, and I do feel that we should look at the choices that have been spoken about tonight for as some safety devices to put into place and move forward with it. And put it, when we get to the point, put a time, a reasonable time frame.
I took the opportunity also to go out, and I agree with all the other you know, comments from the board. It appears that the town has just painted the stop sign lines in town, and the town did paint the one at Fox Hollow. It's a full count of five from that line that you do not see an oncoming car coming towards town. If you come out to the edge of the pavement, it's a count of two. And I purposely was in a very low car. To get the worst case scenario. I found it also interesting that when you drive up and down Grant Road, many of the lines, the stop line, is at the edge of the pavement of Grant Road, not in, you know, almost 10 feet. So, I mean, that even just having the line out by Grant Road would cut down the time, if you will, of not seeing an oncoming car. I mean, I thought that was interesting that the decision was made in one location to paint it at the stop sign, and then in several other locations around Grant Road was to the stop signs back here, and the line is right at Grant Road. So I thought that was kind of odd.
To that point also, is the engineer referenced clearing some of the vegetation.
Mm-hmm.
Is any of that vegetation, would you say, within like the town owner
ownership of the...
The town right-of-way?
Yeah.
Well, definitely, because the town right-of-way, I'm saying visually, looks like it would go up to the stone wall.
Mm-hmm. Should we be clearing some of that already?
I had the same comment about the sign that is, the warning sign, as Rick called it, the driveway entrance sign. The one coming from the Epping side into town, you don't even see it until you're on top of it because there's so much vegetation that has grown out from the bridge area and then up in front of the sign. I mean, so you're really, and you had to look for it. So I'm not sure if people even see the sign there if you're just, you know, casually driving through. I mean, we were all out there really looking for this.
And I agree
with Rick that there was no sign coming the other direction, even though the conditions of approval stated there would have been two signs there. I did have a conversation again with the Public Works Director, and he was not in agreement with the location at the time that this was approved. In 2010, it was reported to the town that the road, you know, had not been accepted by the town. There are no as-builts. So he did have an issue with that. It was certainly his opinion that the as-built should be done and then reviewed by a town engineer, and, you know, as part of the process. So I'll pass that on. And he did have another question that I'll set forward, Diane, is whether or not there's any statute of limitations have run out on this as far as responsibility. So he has some definitive ideas of how to correct the situation, but I don't think that's in the purview of our, you know, not being here. I'd rather have him speak for himself on that. And he also brought up the point that there have been no accidents at this point associated with the subdivision. He was speaking more from the public safety side of that, which is pretty amazing to think about that. But obviously, it could happen at any time. So it seems like we're all in agreement that a notice should be issued because of the findings.
Unless we think that some of these things we've called temporary measures recently, or cutting back the vegetation, moving the stop line up, can be done in advance of issuing a notice like that.
I would think you would want that as part of the notice and add those items to the engineer's report if, in fact, someone wants to make a motion that the remedy, let's use the actual RSA term, is going to be as prescribed by the town engineer. And then we can add to that. But I think keep in mind that anything we add on, it's just going into the notice that's going to go to the developer.
Right.
And you know, is it going to get returned again from Greenland? So
I think
that when we deal with item two, that are we going to make some recommendations to the town council?
Yeah, but it's, I mean, if we voted to approve the issuance of the notice before discussing things that maybe the town could already be doing now without that notice being issued, I think that that's worthy discussion.
Well, we could continue the meeting, and the agenda item is whether or not to issue the notice per the RSA. Mm-hmm. So we could certainly continue the meeting relative to the notice to the next, to July.
Well, I don't really want to.
But at the same time, someone could make a motion that we want the, make recommendations to the town council to take immediate action.
Mm-hmm. Could we separate those into two different own independent motion, independent, so we wouldn't have a continuance. Yeah. We could, I'll say, on notice for this, and secondarily also make a motion to put have the town engineer consider a priority to have some temporary measure in place to make it as safe as possible until more substantial reporting. Yeah.
It's definitely two separate issues, because yes. Okay. the notice of this planning board's decision goes to the
RSA.
Responsible party. Yes. And if that's the developer or the association, that's who the notice gets put to, with the
with a complete identification of what needs to be addressed by a certain time period, failing which the town will step in and do that and then seek, you know, restitution for that money. That's the notice, and we have no leeway relative to the notice other than that we determine it's, we think it's safe and therefore there's no notice. I think the consensus is that everyone agrees it's not safe. So now the action by the board is to give the notice. If we want to continue the discussion relative to what the notice will be, I think that there's some merit to that, unless anyone's ready to make a motion tonight. But then I think the second issue would that for discussion in action would be, what do we want to put forth to the town council for anything that is immediate action to be taken, or relative to a recommendation of whether or not to accept the road, and what are the conditions set forth that we would have prior to them accepting the road.
Can we separate the decision to accept the road from this? That's what I personally would like to do. I think that's it's a very different decision from saying the road is unsafe. And we may need more information before we start accepting a road. But I don't think we need more information to decide that it's unsafe.
Maybe I wasn't clear. It is separate. It's
right, but I mean
separate.
Tonight, in terms of tonight.
Yeah, tonight is separate.
Okay, but I mean, if we feel that we don't have sufficient information to decide whether or not we want to view this as a town road, that can be perhaps continued, but what could, or would that slow the process down for correcting the issue?
The town road portion will be coming after talking about sending this notice.
I understand. I'm talking about tonight. Tonight we were supposed to answer both questions. So I'm just thinking that perhaps we want to focus on the first question primarily tonight and make the decision about whether or not we accept it as a town road at another time, or make a recommendation to the town council as a separate issue. That's a thought.
In advance of both of those questions, as I read the engineer's report, the clearing of the vegetation and the moundage and things like that, if they're within the town's existing right-of-way, it sounds to me like some of the signage and line moving and vegetation clearing that are recommended by the engineers could fall within the town's purview already. And without issuing the notice, what we could possibly do is issue recommendations of that kind to town council tonight, along with a continuance on the decision of the notice, to see if after they've implemented those changes, if it remains unsafe after that. So we could continue the decision of whether or not to issue the notice, even though we agree that it's unsafe as it is. Possibly immediate steps taken by the town council could remedy the situation.
Do you think those recommendations are sufficient?
They're recommended by the town's engineer.
But I'm not sure if they are, personally.
Why wouldn't they be?
Because there's such an elevation differential.
Let's stay focused on the notice if we can, so we can kind of either resolve that or move it forward. So if people can just take a minute to, let's go back to the RSA and see what we have the ability, what we need to do relative to this. And that is, I want to, has anyone found that exact location?
For
the issue of,
it determines improvements are necessary.
If we have
page
determined
two,
yes,
that
it
page
is.
Two. Roman numeral 4, 1, the end of 1. If the board determines that additional improvements are necessary.
Okay, you are under, so it's section 4. No? Where are you, Elizabeth?
Yeah, I'm in section four. I'm just saying if we're truly to evaluate safety concern, I think we are determining there is a safety concern. I think that's what you're asking us to do, correct?
I'm trying to find in the RSA the specific action we need to take.
In the RSA, okay. Then let me see.
Okay, it's in section six.
Okay, of the RSA, okay. The order shall describe the hazard, prescribe what corrective action are. But I don't think we have sufficient information to decide how to correct this. I do not feel we have sufficient analysis done to correct this.
Okay. So the specific RSA is, if any such access is or becomes a potential threat to the integrity of the highway or its surface, ditches, embankments, bridges, or other structures, or a hazard to the safety of the traveling public by reason of siltation, flooding, erosion, frost action, vegetative growth, improper grade, or the failure of any culvert, traffic control device, drainage structure, etc., the Commissioner of Transportation or Planning Board or their designee may issue an order to the landowner or other party responsible for such access to repair or remove such hazardous conditions and obtain any and all permits required therefore. And the order shall subscribe the hazard and prescribe what corrective action or alteration, the location, configuration of access should be required.
That's the point that
and
I
set a reasonable time period.
Okay, and that's the point. I do not feel as if we at this moment on the planning board have the engineering information, skill, or assessment of the situation in order to prescribe exactly what shall be done. But I do think we have enough information to prescribe in order that something needs to be done. And that's the point I'd like to make.
Sure, sure. But it says that
we have the engineering report that was just done.
But we don't have Rick's recommendations, I guess, huh?
And I'm not sure that to me the engineering report is tentative and not sufficient.
So do you want the town to have the engineer go out and do something further?
Can I ask the public?
Do you believe that it's sufficient, the recommendations that are made here by the engineer?
I'm not an engineer, so I'm not qualified to say whether or not, from an engineering standpoint, the road meets the requirements of the RSA in site distances for, and that's why we hire an engineer.
And I understand that, but I just don't feel, given the dramatic elevational change and the short distance between the top of the hill and the entrance of the driveway, that the engineer's recommendations are sufficient. That's my personal view.
So we may want more things to happen.
Exactly. Such as moving the entrance to Fox Hollow, for example. I'm not sure, but I just, you know, I've tried to read this a number of times and I didn't feel that it resolved the situation. And in closing, the engineer says, in summary, the necessary stopping site distance are currently not provided. And it doesn't instill my confidence that his measures, his two bullet points, are sufficient to correct that.
I guess I read it where these were his two recommendations in order to make the public way safe. Did I not?
That's how I read it.
I think these are attempts.
In order to achieve acceptable safety conditions, the following is recommended.
When he says Mound Hill, I mean, is he saying you have to actually, you know, there's a disconnect between the elevation of the Fox Hollow Road and the lower elevation of Grant Hill, and that's a substantial hill. It's more than a little mound or, you know, and vegetation. And in my opinion, I think that we should move to limit the hazard, you know, as immediately as possible, but not rush for a solution without getting a more complete engineering study. That's my personal opinion.
Would people like to do a site walk with the town engineer? Is that, I'm hearing people want more information. I don't, we wouldn't have the capacity to determine what.
Or a second engineering report.
What about including Rick Malowski?
Oh, definitely.
Can I ask for some public input quickly? Is that okay?
Well, I already closed the public.
Yeah. Just ask it to Val.
Well, yeah, okay. I mean, my question would be partly upon the people that live there and have go in and out more frequently than we do. Looking at the engineer's recommendations of the clearing of the vegetation and the mound, things that look to me like something that may fall within the town's purview already.
Mm-hmm.
I would be curious how comfortable they would feel with some of the described remedies we're talking about here, including those by the town engineer, in waiting to decide for the further remedies that may go along with the order. So like, if would they be okay with our making recommendations to the town council tonight that some of these things be completed by the town, would they feel comfortable with that being our first step, or would they like to see more go on this evening, I guess?
I like the idea of the site walk. I mean, so we're all on the same page. Apparently it's in question.
Mm-hmm.
So apparently we need to be out there. We all need to see exactly what these recommendations are and how they physically might change the safety of entering and exiting Fox Hollow. So it's probably safe to say we should postpone the issuance of the notice pending the site walk and issue our recommendations tonight to the town council, saying, you know, stating that vegetation can be removed and signage and whatever else, you know, should be done immediately to reduce the hazard.
I'd agree with that.
Is that safe to say?
Well, I'm not sure that we shouldn't issue a notice that it's hazardous. I think there we're complicating
if
our charge here. I thought our charge was simply to decide whether or not it was hazardous.
If we issue a notice, we have to prescribe the work that needs to be done to correct the situation and a time period in which it needs to be completed.
And can we not issue a notice and at the same time say that we would like further time to remedy the situation because we would potentially like to get a second engineering or more substantial engineering report? This to me is not sufficient.
Why would the developer take any action if he's not required to?
I'm wondering if the RSA truly depends upon our also giving recommendations at the same time. So at the first point, they could say they're on notice, it's unsafe, and we're going to work together to try to remedy this.
Yeah, I'm just reading the RSA. The
sure.
Order shall describe the hazard.
The second part.
Describe what corrective action or alteration in the location or configuration of such access shall be required and set a reasonable time within which the action shall be completed. So the order needs three components.
Mm-hmm. And if you're not giving that second component, there's no point in giving the notice.
Right.
I thought maybe it would be worth a try. That we could
I think you risk
the site walk.
There's no point of sending
it. It wouldn't be a valid notice because
right.
It wouldn't meet the term of the RSA.
Okay, I wasn't sure whether we could do
you're not
one
really
part.
Able to hold them to anything.
Okay,
through
I'm
the
just thinking
of that notice.
Prescribe what corrective action could we phrase it in such a way, say that the corrective action should ensure adequate site distance, for example. We're not saying how it should be done, but we're saying what should be done.
We are prescribing what corrective action or alteration in the location or configuration of such access shall be required. There's no shoulds.
But shall be in terms of we are prescribing that adequate site distance be obtained. We're not telling them
but
how to do it, but we're prescribing that it shall be met.
No, we need to prescribe.
We need to exactly say, prescribe the diagram and okay, then we need a much more substantial engineering assessment in order to do that than even this wouldn't be grossly short, in my opinion, of me giving us any material for that.
So, Adam?
So, sounds like we can make a motion now for recommendations to town council and a separate motion that we, I don't know if we need a separate motion for the sidewalk.
Well, if we're having a sidewalk prior to issuing a notice or prior to determining.
Right.
I think we have to issue a notice because everybody's on record here admitting, you know, stating the public and the board that this is not safe and it's not adequate. I just think by default, you have to issue the notice. So the question is, do we want a site walk first? Because we're trying to determine as part of the order, the prescribing the specific corrective actions or the alteration of the location or configuration of the access, and then determining the reasonable time period. So
it's logical to have the site work before you make the notice.
Yeah, I would
but
agree.
I don't think a site. Okay. I mean, sorry to interrupt.
No, I'm
go
just
ahead,
saying,
and then
oh. If it goes further down the road, it's going to look awful funny that, oh, we gave the notice, but we didn't do the site work, and we had all these questions, so we should do the site walk.
I understand, but I do not think that the site walk alone will be sufficient to give us a precise, accurate, remedied recommendation as prescribed if we are going to really be expected to detail what that corrective action shall be. So I would, in addition to a site walk, ask for a more detailed engineering study with a different engineer. I think it's a critical juncture, and you know, I for one would like much more detailed corrective measure, and I would like to see some plans. I would like to see the layout. I would like something more than two brief bullets.
Before I think asking to spend on another engineer's report, mm-hmm. I think we'd want Rick's input, the public works input.
Yeah.
Exactly. Which he would be there for the site walk.
Because keep in mind, any costs incurred are going to the responsible party.
I do keep that in mind, but I just believe that this assessment strikes me as odd when he's talking about a mound slash hill as if it's an anthill. It's a rise in a road of some, I don't know how many feet, the residents know more than I, but it's a significant rise.
I think it's
elevation.
A mound, it's not an anthill.
Yeah.
I'd call it a hill.
Yeah, but he says
so
he wants
to
be
making a motion, Adam?
Well, I guess, do we need a motion for to schedule a
we need a motion to continue the hearing on the
then I make a motion specific. To continue the hearing on
July 10th.
Well, and to schedule a sidewalk.
The issuance of an order based upon the town of New Market's engineer, Benas and Associates, under RSA 236-13.
To July 10th?
Oh, to July 10th, yeah.
And to schedule a site walk prior to?
And to schedule a site walk prior to.
I'll second.
Okay, any discussion on the motion?
Do we want to include the recommendations to the town council, or are we going to
keep
that separate?
Separate.
Well, okay. Let's just deal with this notice.
Great. Yeah. No more discussion from me.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 All those opposed? Okay. Ayes have it.
Excuse me. Does the sidewalk involve walking the site with an engineer?
Well, we'll talk about that when we figure out how to schedule it.
Okay.
Who we want
okay.
there.
Okay.
Okay. Now, and we'll talk about a date for the sidewalk and how people will be noticed. Moving on to the second issue, does the planning board want to submit through Ed recommendations for
immediate
two
remedy.
Things? Immediate
action
to address some of the issues, you know, this issue, and what those will be, and then. I would say we would probably want to continue discussion on any acceptance as a town road.
So let's just deal with any immediate actions. Is that fair? Okay. Go.
At the least, I think we should recommend immediate action on these bullets from the engineer, the clearing of the vegetation, and the site distance that's obstructed by the mound or hill and vegetation, particularly that which is already within the town's right-of-way.
So, okay, because the town can't do any work on, we have the legal opinion of that, on any private property. So it would be to clearing of the vegetation in the town right-of-way.
Correct.
To improve the line of sight as referenced in the Vanessa report.
Correct.
Okay. Are you getting all this, Ed?
Most of it.
And okay.
And the signage?
Just as a note, it may be a good recommendation, should that not be sufficient, and maybe the clearing on private property of the association, if that could help, maybe they would look into having any additional cleared as well, if it may help that line of sight.
Ed?
I just ask a question.
Sure.
We're being pretty informal. Can I ask them a question? Or it's kind of I think I just came on the board in March, so they already were talking about it on TV, so I just followed this Fox Hall on TV, so I'm just been a little in and out on it. But I think they went out there and did some site walks, and when they had the engineering, and they also did some clearing. I'm not sure if they did some clearing. Did they do some clearing over the mound?
They did. They cleared a few trees off of the lady that was right here.
Okay.
The purple farmhouse, they cleared some right around that bend as you head west towards Epping.
So I think...
Not on
the
left hand side.
So the town council and Rick, I think, have all walked this once before, so they're
okay. So I think the recommendation I'm hearing from the planning board is that we would want the town council, we're recommending that the town council take action to clear the vegetation in the town right of way in the vicinity of Fox Hollow and Grant Road. To improve the line of sight distances as recommended in the Vanessa in the town engineering report.
Could I augment that with a warning signage of some sort, some appropriate warning signage also to be posted?
Well, there was one existing.
There's one coming from Epping.
So that should be included in the clearing of the vegetation.
Correct.
But we need one coming from Granite.
There's no sign coming from
the
correct. So is the recommendation to install a sign?
An additional sign.
Yes.
Okay.
Install a sign.
And so it's visible.
Yeah, they call a warning sign.
And
from
to maintain
east.
The vegetation with both signs, apparently that's not being done.
Right.
I would also add that if they intend to put in a stop sign, that because of the depth of the mound, so to speak, or the valley behind the mound, that they put warning before that to let people know that there's an upcoming stop sign.
I'm getting this, to clear the vegetation prior to the signs.
Mm-hmm. And there's only one existing sign, you said?
Yeah. But if they install another one. The
and hopefully people
conversation about the idea that one of the members of the public offered as far as a three-way stop sign.
I really like that idea. I
thought that was a great idea.
But you need prior warning.
Yeah.
Yes.
The dip.
Yeah.
To the stop. Stop ahead.
Exactly.
Sign, yeah.
That's
so
what I was trying to
so
say
really, there. if that is accepted, then the hazard sign, would that be, first, let me take that back. If the three-way intersection goes in, would it be permanent or would it be short-term, for one? And then if it is only short-term, then the hazard or, you know, the warning signs would obviously stay and be needed.
So until such time that the
Right.
line of sights are improved to make it safe and adequate.
So does that go towards the safety committee too, or?
Probably.
The other part of that three-way stop sign, idea was, I think, possibly your idea, Val, about moving the stop sign line on Fox Hollow.
Further up.
Further up.
Mm-hmm. The stop line? Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I don't know what that term is.
And Ed and Rick, you guys had started to discuss something about like a speed hump or something like that, but I...
No, I don't think you should have a speed hump.
I feel that we need a professional engineer's evaluation of what
should be done
in terms of all of this. I mean, I would feel out of my water, even as a landscape architect,
just cut that conversation short earlier. Okay.
Well, that's a question. I mean, Elizabeth is wanting a different engineer to look at this, you know.
I'm just conservative about
this. So, I mean, that's going to be a recommendation to the, you know, if we make that recommendation to the council, they would have to hire another engineer.
So is our engineer licensed?
I'm not doubting his
engineering is being questioned, you're questioning the license, it seems.
Well, I think what I'm questioning really is the second bullet, how it's worded and what that how he's referring to. I maybe we just need to talk to him for further clarification, because I think there's a lot of substantial grading that needs to be done, and how that's worded is very funny to me.
Okay.
And do you understand what
I'm
saying?
So you want clarification of the town engineer's recommendations.
Maybe that's a better way of putting it, and then seeing if I seem that's sufficient or not. I mean, I don't mean to be, I'm just trying to do my best here to try to make sure that it's going to be safer.
It came across as constantly trying to second guess engineer that we have employed.
No, I'm not trying to second guess him. I'm sorry, and I apologize to the engineer if I'm doing that. Perhaps it's just a question of my interpretation of his grammar.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, it's not clear. There's no plan to say, hey, take this tree out and take this where the mound is.
There's no diagram. Mm. There's no
I'd like to see it.
Yeah.
So you have
Okay, so making the intersection a three-way stops intersection until such time as the line of sight corrections are made.
With additional
are implemented.
Warning. I do apologize to Mr. Hom. Okay. I don't mean to impugn his reputation. I take back anything bad I've said. It's just a question of how it's written.
Any other recommendations we want to move forward for some immediate action by the council? No? So I think we identified five. Clearing of the, Ed, can you read those back? Or do you have five?
I have the vegetation clearing, that installing the warning signs, installing three-way stop sign, clarification of town's engineer report.
That will be on, have that for Diane on the sidewalk. Move the stop line to Grant Road, consistent with Hilton Drive. I think it was Hilton Drive, right?
Yeah, it was.
And then also clearing the vegetation prior to any of the warning signs.
On right away,
mm-hmm.
Grant, Fox Hill Road, prior to signs, yeah.
Did you have putting in the warning sign?
Yeah, install additional warning sign of the intersection on the New Market side. Okay. All right. So let's have this as a motion so that it's of record that this is action that we want the town council to take.
Can you pass down the paper?
Yeah, I know.
I didn't write it down.
Cheat sheet. Okay.
Mama. All right, if I can read. Make a motion. The board of directors, planning board.
that was this morning's meeting.
Planning board recommends to the town council the following recommendations.
That the town take immediate action.
Take immediate, that the town take immediate action on the following recommendations. One, clearing of vegetation in the town.
Right of way.
Right of way. Two, install additional warning signs of intersection on.
The New Market side.
On the New Market side. Three, clear vegetation prior to any.
Warning.
Warning signs in existence. Four, have intersection as a three-way stop intersection or additional warning signs.
With additional.
With additional warning signs. Till such time have.
As the line of sight.
As the line of sight corrections.
Implemented.
Are implemented. And five, move stop line to Grant Road in, consistent with Hilton Drive.
A second.
Here we go. Get it moving.
Okay. We'll have Janice second for the record. All, any more discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion passes. Third item. Can I have a motion that we take up the issue of a recommendation relative to relative to the town council deliberating on accepting Fox Hollow Road as a town road?
I move to continue that until July 10th.
Is there a second?
Second.
Well, any discussion?
I think he said he wants to continue it to July 10th, didn't you?
Or have it. It will be on the July 10th agenda.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I just wonder. I'm just thinking what, you know, what further information we might need to assist with that decision on July on July 10th. And maybe there needs to be some information we might want.
Well, I just want to, like, get it on the agenda.
Oh, get it on the agenda. Right. Okay. Potentially, we may need some other information to make that decision.
Like the bond.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And potentially an as-built and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Maybe a clarification on the maintaining of the road, where that direction came from.
Yeah, well, but I think that's already been addressed.
Yeah, that's what they're stopping
by
that.
The attorney. Yeah.
Okay, so did you make the motion?
I
second it.
Yep.
Thank you. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Nay. So that will be on the July 10th meeting. It's difficult to schedule the site walk now because we will need to coordinate time of if we want the engineer there.
Okay, that's what I was going to ask.
And also the public works director. Okay. So if we can do that by
email?
Email, I hope we can. And it will be publicly noticed, yes. So that will be okay. We'll come up with a date and we'll have it publicly noticed at the site walk.
Okay.
And I'll find out when Diane gets back, or I'll call Sue and how much time that needs
so
to be
engineer
done.
So the engineer could be
and
with
have
us.
Her working on that.
Great.
That would
be great.
So we'll move forward with that.
And do you have, oh, I'm sorry.
We can notify
do you have the homeowners association's email address so you can notify him?
You are good.
I'm quiet, but I know.
So, Mr. Wheeler, okay, if you could leave us contact information so that the planning department can give you notice of when the site walk will be, and then if you could notify, because it's really not an abutter kind of a, you know, a public notice. So that would be great if you could assist with that. Okay. Thank you so much for your patience. I know you've been dealing with this for a long time, and I know you have to deal with it every day, many times a day. We hope you can appreciate how our hands are tied on some of these issues, and we can't just say, hey, let's go do this, because we really do have the regulations that we need to abide by. And obviously, we are representing the town. I would definitely encourage you to attend in mass. This is a great turnout when any of these issues come before the town council, or to call, you know, the town council members, send a letter or whatever. So I do appreciate that. Okay, and I look forward to seeing everyone out on Fox Hollow, and hopefully some things will get done, and it'll be a little safer as each day moves forward. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So I'll follow up with Sue tomorrow on getting that set up. Oh, my goodness.
Gracious.
I will put into the record that the email sent to me by Victor, Jade? I completely apologize for this. I will put into the record the email received from Mr. Bilodeau on Thursday, that I received through Thursday, June 7th, regarding his comments that he wanted to be in the record. So I will actually submit that to be included in the record of this meeting. And the comments were reiterated by some of the other members. So I completely apologize. I should have read that in before I closed public comments, and we'll make sure that those are in the record, okay?
Will we have a copy of that?
Yeah,
you should have had a copy of that, but I'll make sure that gets submitted. Okay.
I just went to my box and I have some.
See, I didn't go to Twitter.
But I didn't get that in my
box. Okay. I'll make sure that Sue sends that to everyone.
Can I ask you just a procedural question? Is everything.
If we could have conversations taken out because our meeting is still going on, thank you.
So would we typically.
And hold on, Ed and Jane, if we can. Elizabeth has been recognized. Yes, sir.
Oh, I just wanted to know if typically we would get all pertinent information, we would get printed out copies for everything. Are we expected to supplement copies that are in our cubbies with our printing things ourselves? No. From attachments, from emails? And
we
just want to clarify whether
Should be get anything that is emailed to us, a printed copy, excuse me, should be in our boxes.
That's what I thought.
You're not
okay.
Expected to be. You can do that out of your own.
Okay. Okay. I just wanted to.
No.
Thank you.
No. Absolutely. There were a lot of things that have been emailed, and they're not in the boxes. So I'll just I'll remind Sue that anything that gets sent to a board member, hard copy, should go in the box.
Thank you.
Unless someone tells her otherwise.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks.
All right. Okay. Moving on under new and old business. We have get organized
from
here.
Cynthia?
Okay. Cynthia was going to be on the agenda. I spoke with her earlier today. Basically, this has to do with the preparation for the update to the land use and the future land use chapter. So I spoke with her about perhaps having this at a workshop. I'd like to talk a little bit more to the planning board about scheduling a couple of workshops during the year to deal with regulations, site plan subdivision regulations, and so that we're not, because otherwise we would be here till very late in the evening. So would people be willing to do that? Like maybe it would be probably like the fourth Tuesday of the month, and it will be on an as needed basis. I think it will just be better, because then we're not, we really can just focus on some of these regulations and updates that we need to start to address. So I'll talk to Diane about that when she gets back. I don't hear anyone saying no. So relative to the preparation for the update to the land use and the future land use chapter, Cynthia just sent over a note on that. It's, again, this is all, she's waiting on the New Hampshire Coastal Program for the approval. They approved the Stratford Regional Planning Commission's grant application. So now it's just waiting on Governor and Executive Council to sign off. And they'll be ready to begin the work on the contract in July. The scope of the work for the New Market project will encompass updates to two chapters of our master plan. So activity number four is the Stratford Regional Planning Commission will assist the town of New Market in preparing an update of the land use and future land use chapters of the master plan. They'll complete the traditional update of the existing land use chapter. The future land use chapter will focus on the climate adaptation and resiliency and will identify community vulnerabilities and establish goals to protect coastal infrastructure and resources.
the deliverable will be a draft master plan chapters on land use and future land use. The two chapters that they'll be working on, they'll be available on the town website for, they are available on the town website for downloading. And so again, those are those two chapters, land use and future land use. There'll be preparatory steps that the planning board and staff need to take to prepare for the workshop, which is part of the grant. Obviously, we'll be reading the chapters as we have, making notes on the sections, things that need to be updated, reviewing the data and the maps, think about what kind of revisions and additions are going to be good to add, kind of giving a time frame for historic land use data, going through the different tasks, what tasks are not relevant, and if there's any new areas to discuss. So so Cynthia definitely was in agreement to do this at a workshop, and it will probably result in, like we've done with the update of the economic development chapter, would be a small task force of the planning board that would be assigned to work on this. So start thinking about if you have an interest in it and would be willing to work in that capacity. That is.
Would we then have with these? We can use our current copies of the master plan as for these chapters.
Exactly.
We don't need new copies. We can use our current.
Yeah, whatever the current is, and then it would be a matter of the updating.
Okay.
Also, under new old business. Elizabeth, you have anything to report on the landscaping and regulation subcommittee?
I was just going to ask, since that follows that, as you know, I've been busy with caregiving in Connecticut, so I haven't had much chance to pursue that. Unfortunately, I've asked a couple of people who haven't found it of interest to them. And I have not yet heard from interested public members who would like to be on this committee. And so far, it's just Janice and myself that are evaluating something that is largely done, but we would like help from someone who is not officially appointed to the planning board to assist with reviewing the updated regulations. So please contact me if you're interested in being on the committee. Thank you.
And some, you know, maybe someone from the Newmarket Gardeners might be willing, or I mean, if you want to talk to Cynthia, there's a couple of folks at Bryant Rock who are pretty active in landscaping.
Okay, maybe I'll give Cynthia a call. Okay.
So maybe we'll have a report in July, or again, at the workshop. It's a perfect workshop item. Rick, CIP?
CIP met, and I was appointed chairman. we've started to ask all the town people, all the town employees, managers, to submit their plans and the needs for the coming year. They should be in by July 16th, and we will hold our first meeting July 17th, and that'll be like every 2 weeks on a Thursday. Thereafter, we're going to see all the places. One problem is by law, we need another person from the planning board to be the backup member. So I'd like to have somebody somebody volunteer to be a backup member. And I'll be glad to provide you with the information that we've got so far.
And Jane?
Well, yeah, I'd be happy to. They had mentioned it. I work at Liberty Mutual in the finance department. I can't balance a checkbook, but I do a lot of I'm a contract manager for Liberty, meaning I go out and I buy all of Liberty Mutual's IT stuff. So if I can be in help anyway, as long as I don't have to add, I'm good.
All right, I'll get your email and I'll send you out all the paperwork. Maybe Susan do it, and then we'll give you a listing of the meetings.
Yeah, because she had mentioned it, and I said that I would do it.
They are at 4:00 in the afternoon.
That's okay. It's a good reason to get out of work. So
there you go.
Okay, so I will formally appoint Jane Fort as the alternate planning board member to the CIP committee.
Right.
Okay. Advisory Heritage, Elizabeth, anything to report on that?
I did not say that I would necessarily be on Advisory Heritage.
Oh, should I be Elizabeth?
Oh, no, excuse me, I am on Advisory Heritage. Excuse me, I was thinking that was the other.
No, that was SRPP, yeah.
Yes, Stratford Planning, yes, okay, Stratford Planning.
I do have a question mark on that one.
Okay, yes, so now that's the one I was saying in May, too. Okay, Advisory Heritage, we have had one meeting, and we're trying to arrange for another. I don't believe that, I am sworn in, and I am an official member. I don't believe anything of material interest transpired on our first meeting, except we agreed to meet again, and we're going to then be making an agenda. I did ask for some sort of copy of the mission. I wanted to be, and that is going to be forthcoming. So once we know the mission, that's a good place to start from my perspective.
Mm-hmm. Hopefully it's going to be June 28th.
Well, that was going back and forth.
The mission is online.
Oh, is that?
No, okay. But it's not, yeah. We'll information to new members.
Yeah.
Janice, anything on the Conservation Commission?
Well, I know that June 16th, I believe, is the Fishing Derby. And we are going also to, they have a really good format of having their goals outlined and to make sure they're staying on target of their goals. It's a nice format that they've gone through that we've been setting up, and they're having Sue, the code enforcer, come down to speak to the Conservation Committee at our next meeting to see how we can work together, because she keeps us in ordinance in her role versus our role, which is a nice idea, because I'm new on the Conservation Committee, and Dan Wright is new, and it's a good idea,
right,
so
idea.
We get to know our roles and responsibilities within different departments of the town, and so that's going to come up. But and then they gave money to the oyster reef coming up, but that's really where we're at. We meet this Thursday. You asked before we meet. We should ask after we meet.
Well, I'm asking about your last meeting.
Well, yeah.
Well, Peter was chairing our TRC committee, so we'll be looking for a replacement to kind of coordinate that. I don't know if Heather or Justin, if you had any interest when applications come in.
Right,
and I don't want to keep you busy on. Ed, would you be willing to?
Co-something with somebody, but with the planning board and the town council, I've got a full deck right now.
Okay, because this would be relative to a review of plans, so the engineer's review and, okay. So would you be interested in participating on the on the TRC?
If there's no other volunteers, I would do it.
All right.
And I'll be his backup.
All right, that's great.
How's that?
I'll be your backup.
Okay.
And as applications come in, that is our role. It's obviously to. And I'm sorry, Adam. I mean, oops, I didn't.
Maybe
the two of these. So yeah.
Because
I don't do these guys.
Well, Adam wants it.
No, I don't. I would have to.
Okay.
See how the summer schedule is.
All right. So let's leave it at this. Instead of having a standing TRC committee, as an application comes in, let's form the three people we're going to serve. Okay. By application. Maybe that will just work better. Okay.
I was on the TRC.
Good. Because it's that's really important, because so much of what happens at the TRC is we're relying on your recommendations when the application is before the board of things that we need to have as conditions and approvals, or what didn't get done, or on the plans. So that's really, really important, because we, as a board, it's really difficult to have all the members review in detail these plans. So the way it really should work is the plan should come into the town planner for review. They should determine if the application is complete. And then the code enforcement officer is also supposed to give comments on it to review to see if it's to make sure that any of the proposed uses or the, anything on the plan is making sure it's in compliance with our zoning. And if not, then obviously we can't act upon unless there's a variance. We should be getting a copy of the full application. If it's determined to be complete, then the planner should have it on the next agenda. If it's not complete, it should not go on the agenda. We should then be getting a copy of the application and anything that is with that. And they're going to start to do that because I have talked to Sue and they are giving notice that the applicants need to provide 12 copies of everything that they're giving. So we don't have incomplete packets. We should be getting them as soon as Diane determines that, you know, that that application is complete, so that we have a few weeks to review this. And then we'll request, and then there's a certain time period under our procedures of when we should be getting comments from the planner relative to the application. Once, so that should all happen well before our meeting, so that everybody is prepared and any questions that we want to ask, we've seen, you know, that we can do that. Once an application is accepted, then we'll assign a TRC committee to meet with the, you know, the applicant and the town planner and the town engineer. The town engineer, once an application is accepted, should then review the plan for compliance with our regulations, unless a waiver has been granted, or to use their comments if we're going to grant a waiver. You know, we might be relying on the engineer's comments for that, because any waiver request should be in the application. And then, you know, once we have that, the TRC can meet with the applicants and then formulate that TRC committee's comments back to the board when the applicant comes for the next meeting. So it really, you know, if the process is kind of adhered to, it should not be burdensome on the applicant or the planning board to get through these applications and to be fair to all the parties involved.
Yeah, it's the last thing we want to do is get here and then tell somebody that we don't have, there's something else we want to see, come back in a month.
Absolutely. So. You know, not once we accept that application, we have 90 days to act.
Yep.
And we can either deny it without prejudice so they can come back. Or if the parties agree, we can continue it. But otherwise, we have to take action to approve the conditions or deny, or deny without prejudice. So I'll have that discussion with Diane also. Is there any other? Well, there is one item of also new business. We need to elect a new vice chair.
I nominate Janice Rosa as vice chair.
Second.
Janice, how do you feel about that?
Yeah, any discussion on the matter?
Yeah, Long's Vale is always here.
You can't make that commitment, and I have no question in my mind that you would do equally or better job than I. So, there being no more discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The record show that was a unanimous aye.
I have one thing under new business.
Yes, other new business.
If you don't, do you have anything else?
Nope, that's everything I
have. I was just wondering, because some of us have failed. We have some new alternates, and welcome, Jane. I didn't meet you.
Thank you, Janice.
Same here. Jane is new. Ed is new. Elizabeth is fairly new. She came on fairly, you know.
Swiftly.
And Justin was an alternate, but he came on very swiftly. And it doesn't hurt senior members to go and have a workshop to review our roles and what we should be aware of to ask applicants at a meeting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I don't know if that's anything that new members would like. I mean, I know I always benefit from having reviews too.
Yeah.
Yeah. The fall. That's a really good issue that you brought up, because the state who runs it, LGC.
Oh.
They run the sessions in the spring and the fall, the planning and zoning workshops, mm-hmm. and they're held throughout the state and they rotate around. They're incredible workshops to go to. They're day-long workshops. There's a lot of useful information. It kind of and there are certain sessions that are specifically set aside for new planning board members or the role of a new planning mm-hmm. board member. They're just, you know, they're great sessions to attend. So that's spring and in the fall.
And then every so often, we'll get notices of different seminars going on, you know, the LGC or other, or maybe Stratford Regional Planning might be hosting. The town will pay any costs associated with your attendance, mileage, as well as any of the admissions costs or to attend. So please take advantage of that. Okay. If you just want additional information, also Diane's office has a plethora of, you know, information on roles of planning board members. And then I hope too that as we do some more workshops that, or start doing workshops, these will be kind of the discussions that we'll have. You know, let's review our operating procedures and our own bylaws and you know, what's working, what's not, and what needs to be changed. Because, you know, if the process isn't working for people, let's make sure we know that and figure out how to make it work. So thanks for bringing that up. Any other new or old business? We did not report on the Economic Development Committee, the Zoning Update Committee. I should, because I'm going to report on economic development, so I don't want to have a motion yet. I kind of stopped after TRC. Stratford Regional Planning designee, Elizabeth was still thinking about that.
Yes, at that time I cannot commit
okay.
to that. At
so,
this time I
all right. So if there's any member of the public who might be interested, please, you know, contact Diane. We do have a representation of the town of Newmarket for that. Zoning update.
I just want to tell you, I'm still on the mailing list, so when they send me stuff, I send it to Diane.
Okay, that's great.
So, just to keep everybody informed. Hmm.
Justin or Janice, why don't you kind of just give a general update on our last meeting for the zoning update?
Vice Chair?
I did it last time, so I want you to do it this time.
All right, well, I don't know the tax number. We were focusing on the northern end of Route 108, and you wouldn't happen to know the lots.
The B1 area on 108.
The B1 area.
Elm Street.
Which really has several residential properties with, what is it, a couple multi-unit.
Yeah.
Rentals or apartment buildings that we really didn't feel that the one parcel that was in the center of that really fit into the character of that zone. It was zoned commercially. We feel it doesn't really fit there, so we're making recommendations that that be rezoned to fit the current zone that's there. Is that?
Yeah, okay. That's in that... the Elm Court, the back end, Nichols Ave, Washington, Lincoln. There's kind of like this orphan lot.
That was the end that had the proposal.
Right. That
yes. Is that still going
Decker
strong?
Decker and Bill Doucette. I actually did get a call from Mr. Decker yesterday, and he was just kind of looking for an update. Sue had given him my number because Diane wasn't there. So I told him that, you know, that the committee had met and will be, you know, bringing something forward to the planning board. And the recommendation of the committee was to have everyone in the district and abutters notified so that when we're discussing it, you know, the interested parties, you know, would be here if they had any comments. And so
you're a lot better at this
maybe
than I am.
July or August. So I just wanted to answer
well,
that.
Sure.
See, and for what it's worth to me, in looking at that, I understand maintaining the character, but something kind of neat about Newmarket to me is the history of the village feel that it's had, where there have been commercial and retail interests and lots kind of sprinkled throughout the village, something like where the L&M is at now. certain things on Spring Street we've recently granted variances to be, you know, residential instead. But in some ways, it's neat to have the opportunity for little corner stores and things like that to go in, I think. So.
Yeah, and we talked about that on the Elm Street side, is because right now it's B1, so it really prohibits the mixed use.
Right.
But to maybe make that an M2.
Right.
And then the other section, R3, you know, when you're off that.
Yeah, sure.
So, yeah, I'm kind of excited about that. I think it kind of brings you back to Old Newmarket.
Right.
So maybe July we'll, you know, get that forward.
Bring my notes next time.
That was good. It was
Excellent. Black Bear TIF. The, we haven't had a meeting. It was canceled in light of what the is happening with the town council. So there's been no meeting. And I don't think there will be a meeting until any action is taken by the council on that. Kind of segueing into the town council meeting last week, on the agenda was the Chapter 6 of the Master Plan Economic Development recommendations relative to council action. And I did take the opportunity to go to the meeting and speak, I'm going to say on behalf of the planning board, because as part of that, you know, we're responsible for the master plan, and as that was adopted last year, there were specific specific recommendations, as people will recall, relative to the implementation of Chapter 6 and identification of the parties who would be responsible and time periods based upon, you know, priority levels, you know, with some task items to be completed within 0 to 6 months, 6 to 12 months, or, you know, 12 to 24 months. And that was adopted last August, yet nothing has happened since that time. And to really move that move the recommendations that are in that Chapter 6 forward, the first responsible tasks are fall on the council. So I did speak to that. I think that there were some really good questions that were asked, and hopefully the council will move that forward.
What is one of the more significant issues that you think?
Well, the biggest one was identifying who's responsible for economic development in Newmarket.
Okay.
And the town council is the only one that can determine who that is. Are they going to hire an economic development entity person, or are they going to put the responsibility on a existing committee, a new committee or commission? Will the responsibility fall under, you know, a current employee or department?
Because the other committee had expired pretty much, or with the building of the mills, that had sort of taken a back step. Development committee.
No, there's still the Newmarket Community Development Corporation. But okay, if the town council says that, hey, we'd like you to be in charge of economic development for Newmarket, you know, the council needs to, in that case, the NCDC would need to accept.
Okay.
If the town council says, you know, let's have an economic development commission or a committee, and the council will determine what is comprised of that committee. And I did speak to that, because it makes sense if you move forward in that direction, you would have participants from various, you know, the Newmarket Business Association, the Newmarket Community Development Corporation, the Planning Board, the Advisory Heritage Board, I mean, commission, not a committee. So, you know, people who really have a strong economic background and that can, you know, really add some value to that committee. One of the other high priority items was having a visioning session done in the community to determine what do, you know, the residents in town and the taxpayers want to see relative to economic development. Where do they want to see it? What do they want to see? And to get all that input so that, you know, once that phase is done, then the planning board can say, okay, now our role is to ensure that the regulations provide for it. And if they don't, how do we need to either make recommendations from changes in zoning for the council to adopt, or recommendations in our site plan and subdivision regulation reviews? So, but we can't really, you know, we're doing something short-term relative to this zoning update, you know, to be able to facilitate some economic development. But to do something town-wide really needs the input of the town. And somebody needs to spearhead that. And someone also needs to be the voice of the town in talking to potential developers or going out and finding developers or economic entities to come in.
Okay, thank you.
So I thought it was, I'm glad they asked the questions and allowed me to speak. So I think that we'll be hearing more from Ed on town council reporting from that perspective. And I didn't, actually mean to not have you on the list, but is there anything from the town council to report relative to the what the planning board should know?
No, sewage, you don't care about sewage and water, right?
Well, yeah, just as long as there's enough to let people build.
That's right.
Especially if it's commercial.
Sean Gray came up and he was talking about, you know, one of the sewage and the water, and on Bay Road, we're going to have to do some work on Bay Road, probably down the line here, and come up with some funds, so we passed that. We are doing the, this isn't so much planning board, but town administrator, we are meeting, and there was a press release, I think it just went out, that that we haven't chosen
found,
found anybody yet, but the process is still going on. Right. So it's very close.
Excellent.
It's getting there.
Thank you. Any other old new business? Any motions?
Motion to adjourn?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.